everyone. Welcome to our Facebook Live presentation here at ProMedica. Today we're talking about brain health, everything neuro. And I have the guy to talk about this. This is Dr. Kevin Reinard, and he is a neurosurgeon here at ProMedica. Sees amazing things all the time. And really, Dr. Reinard, our brains are incredible, incredible organs, aren't they? So many things happening in our brains that, I mean, most of which are subconscious that we don't even know are going on, right?
Exactly.
So I think maybe one of the things is, you know, we all think in terms of keeping our bodies healthy and being fit physically. Are there things we can do to keep our brains healthy and active?
Sure you can. I mean, think of the brain as an extension of your body. So if you want to have a healthy body, you have to have a healthy mind and a healthy brain, and vice versa. So just like there are things that you can do to keep the brain healthy, like exercising, having a good diet, not smoking, not drinking alcohol excessively, you can do those same things to protect your brain.
Let's talk about sleep, because that is really a big factor for your brain too, right? We need to rest our brains at night.
Correct. Well, there's tons of data that supports this notion that people who sleep well, and in fact, people who take naps live longer. So there's definitely a correlation between healthy sleep and a healthy body and mind. And also there's data from the world of brain science that supports the idea that a lot of the chemicals that are secreted in the brain are actually excreted and eliminated when we sleep. So when we're awake, the brain is creating and producing a lot of toxins, and those toxins are excreted when we're sleeping. So it's very important. It's vital for people to get good sleep.
So we want to take your questions here today, because we know the brain is such a fascinating thing. All of us use our brains in a variety of ways every day. We're going to talk a little bit about some brain disease today. We're going to talk about brain health. We want your questions. We're going to talk about some amazing breakthroughs in brain surgeries that our neurosurgeons are using now. And we want to hear from you today. We also want to let you know that this is a public space, right? We're on social media. So although we are happy to take your questions as it relates to brain health here today, remember that this is public space. People are going to be able to see your questions. They're going to be able to see names and information that you put there. So be very careful to protect your privacy if you're interested in doing that, and be mindful of the personal information you share or other people's personal information that you share on this space here today. Okay, so we are taking your questions, and if you have any questions, you just let me know about it. I'm gonna be kind of looking here. We're trying to get this little space to work. Having trouble here, Katie. I'll have my trusty assistant come in here and maybe figure this out for me while I'm continuing to ask Dr. Reinard some questions. I know that this is September is aneurysm awareness month. What is an aneurysm exactly, and how do we know if we might be in danger of an aneurysm?
An aneurysm, the way I think of it, is essentially a blister that forms on a blood vessel in the brain that has a weak portion of the wall. So if there's a weakness in the wall of the blood vessel, that section of the blood vessel has a tendency to pouch out and creates a blister. And that blister then has a tendency to rupture. And if the aneurysm were to rupture, then that could potentially cause catastrophic bleeding.
How would I know if I might be in danger of one? Like, do you feel them? Do you have pain? How do we know?
Well, that's a difficult thing with aneurysms, is that a lot of times we're not aware, patients aren't aware that they have aneurysms. So it's unfortunate in that regard. And that's why if an aneurysm were to rupture, for example, somebody could die suddenly without knowing. But, you know, nowadays with the advent of all the imaging technologies, we're seeing a lot more aneurysms discovered early, because if somebody has a headache, for example, if they sustain an injury to the head, they obtain a scan of the head, which may show an incidental aneurysm.
Yeah.
And then there are also families that have a high propensity of aneurysms or a high density of aneurysms, which we know about, for example.
So there siblings. Is a familial connection, perhaps.
Yes, there is a familial connection, but it's very rare. So it's very rare that families or multiple individuals and families will have aneurysms. But it's known, and we know about it.
What can you do about aneurysms? What do you do for them?
Well, not all aneurysms are dangerous. So it depends on the location, the size, and the overall condition of the person. But if you know about an aneurysm, certainly you want to get in touch with a neurologist or see a neurosurgeon and discuss potential treatment options. The vast majority of aneurysms that I see in my clinic, we simply follow for a long period of time. And here at ProMedica, we have a collective team of not only neurosurgeons, but also stroke neurologists that can treat aneurysms in a non-surgical way.
Right.
And so what we do is we discuss these cases on an annual basis, or excuse me, on a monthly basis, and try to come up with an individual plan that best suits that individual, that person.
So what are you hoping that people might take away from aneurysm awareness month? What should we as just general patients know about aneurysms?
Well, for the general public, it's important to know that, excuse me, if you know of somebody who has an aneurysm, who hasn't sought care, that they probably should get in touch with their family physician or at least see a specialist. But it's also important to know that aneurysms could potentially rupture and cause complications. So if you know somebody who's been acting different, who hasn't been themselves, potentially may have a headache, personality has changed, be aware that it could potentially be an aneurysm rupture. Mm-hmm. Take that individual to the ER and get them scanned. We have seen cases, one or two cases here at ProMedica, of patients who have had symptoms, have had neurologic symptoms that have been neglected. And it turned out that they had aneurysms.
So it's important for us to also just observe this, maybe in family members or friends, right? To be able to tell them, because they may not even be aware that they're acting differently or that this might be a sign of something bigger.
Correct.
Yeah. Are there any risk factors? Am I at a higher risk if I am overweight, or is there something that might put me at a higher risk for an aneurysm?
Generally speaking, when patients come to my clinic and I counsel them on aneurysms, there's a set of risk factors. Aneurysms in certain locations in the brain have a higher probability of rupturing. It's been known that if in females, the tendency to rupture is a little bit higher than in men. And smoking is a very high risk factor. So if you smoke and you have a history of an aneurysm, you certainly ought to stop smoking. And then there's also some genetic disorders. For example, if somebody has a connective tissue disorder, they could potentially be at a higher risk of a rupture.
So just important to, take charge of your health, be very proactive if you're noticing any of those symptoms, to be able to, tell somebody that you're noticing symptoms in them, or just be aware of it in yourself and your family members, that you can help them to get to the proper person to check it out and just make sure that they're okay. Because there are a variety of things that you can do, right?
Exactly, yeah.
To help people like that. And brain surgery is not what it used to be, I have had the amazing honor of being in the operating room with Dr. Reinard on a couple of occasions. And it's simply amazing to watch what you can do through tiny, tiny hole, right? Sometimes in someone's head, to be able to reach some of these problem areas. You have seen some amazing breakthroughs in technology since you have started practicing, and you're a young guy.
Right. Well, I'm not that young anymore, but just to give the audience perspective, Harvey Cushing, who's considered the father of neurosurgery in this country, had complication rates that were close to 40%. And he's considered one of the greatest neurosurgeons ever.
Yeah.
Right now, if you look at the overall complication, like for example, of our group at ProMedica, it's in the neighborhood of 1-2%.
Wow.
And that's not necessarily because we're better than Harvey Cushing, but that's just a testament of how far the science has come, mm-hmm. how far the technology has come, how good our supporting staff are, how good the science of anesthesia is, and so forth.
We're going to talk about some of that technology too coming up, but we do want to invite you to ask your questions about all things brain here for the next hour until 1 o'clock. We're going to be here talking with Dr. Kevin Reinard. If you're just joining us, welcome. We do want to remind you that we are trying to be mindful of personal information here on this very public space. So try not to use other people's names or put information out there that you don't want other people to see, because this is a public space and people will be able to see that. But we do invite your questions on anything that has to do with neurology or your brain, any kind of brain illness or brain procedure. And I want to talk a little bit about some of the new technology that you're using, because it really is an exciting time for surgeons. Also, it should be an exciting time for patients, you know, to know about some of these new technologies that you're using. So tell us a little bit about some of that. One of the things I know that is new in our system is the bright matter.
Sure.
And Modus V that you all are using in the operating rooms. And this is an amazing, not only an amazing technology, you're getting ready to do your 100th surgery, or you just did your 100th surgery with bright matter.
Sure.
So it's become quite a tool for you. Tell us how it works.
So in general, again, just so that the audience has perspective, the paradigm of surgery has shifted to a point where we are now focused on minimal invasion of tissues. So you're talking, you know, smaller incisions, smaller openings in the brain, minimal retraction of important brain tissues or pathways, as compared to before, where if you look at some of the historical pictures, you know, the incisions were much larger. There was a lot of damage to the surrounding tissues. And the reason that's the case is because the patients do better, right? If the incision is smaller, the duration of surgery is less or shorter. If the surrounding tissues aren't as damaged, then the patients recover much quicker. And again, it's all because of the advances in technology. So this bright matter technology, for example, is a form of technology that takes advantage of diffuser tensor imaging pictures of the brain.
Which means?
Well, there's a lot of physics behind that statement,
yeah.
But essentially what the computer is doing is utilizing the motion of water molecules in the brain and formulating a hologram of all the tracks in the brain based on the way the water molecules are diffusing. And then it renders this image that shows the relationship between all the pathways, so all the information pathways, in relationship to the surrounding structures. So if you have, for example, a tumor that's in the frontal lobe, it could potentially disturb or push some of the information highways that go from the front of the brain all the way to the back of the brain. Okay, and we have the technology.
And you're able to see that, well, if that's happening.
We are able to see it. We're not able to see it in the patient's brain, but we are able to see it on the computer screen because of this bright matter technology.
Mm-hmm.
And we have various ways of avoiding those critical structures. So it's a fascinating technology because it prevents us as surgeons from getting into trouble.
So basically, you're able to kind of mark a path for yourself to get to whatever the issue is without harming some of the parts of the brain that might prevent us from mobility or speech or any of those types of things. Is that correct?
Correct. Yeah. So the whole objective of doing any brain operation for a brain tumor is to try to take the tumor out as best as one can, try to take as much of it out as one can, and not to disturb any of the surrounding structures. And so what this technology does, it allows you to get to the location of the tumor without disturbing the pathways that may be in the way, and get there safely, do the surgery, take out as much of the tumor as possible, and then come back out without any disturbance to the surrounding tissues. And as a consequence, the patients do much better. The recovery time is shorter, and patients don't have as much of the postoperative complications as they may have in the past.
The really wonderful thing too is, you told me that it also helps you to know how far you can push, right? Like, whereas you may have stopped a little sooner before because you couldn't really see what you were getting yourself into.
Right.
Now you know that you could maybe push a little farther, push the boundary a little farther,
so
right?
Most of the tumors that we take out look very different than the surrounding brain, the normal brain tissue. So
mm-hmm.
That's what we relied on. We've historically relied on our understanding of the tissue And we can differentiate it from the, you know, the abnormal from the normal, but sometimes you can't. Sometimes you have lower grade tumors that may look just like the brain, right? And so then surgeons tend to run into trouble because you assume that what you're taking out is tumor and you try to push the envelope, patient wakes up and they may have some deficit, right? Related to injuring those critical structures. Well, with this device, the computer actually calculates a volume that's safe to resect. And while we're doing the surgery, there's a probe that we can utilize that can map out the area around the tumor. And you can see exactly how far you can push your resection and where to stop.
Yeah.
So
as a surgeon, that has to be really exciting for you because, as you said, you're able to get more of the tumor without damaging any of the functions that people need to, you know, go on with their life afterward, right?
Right. Well, it's exciting for us because, you know, my main objective as a surgeon is to do the best that I can for the patient. And so if I can take a tumor out, obtain a diagnosis, and not harm the patient, it makes the experience that much better.
Right. And then talk a little bit about the MODIS 5 kind of arm of this too, because there's a new tool that you are able to use, not exactly a robot, but it's a microscope that helps you really to be able to see and work in a way that's a little better physically for you as well. So explain that.
Right. So the MODIS is actually a robotic arm. And what it is, it's an external exoscope, if you will. So it's not an endoscope. It's essentially a visual optic system that is mounted on a robotic arm that can follow me around the operating room without me having to manipulate a microscope, for example. And what that allows me to do is I can focus on the patient and use both hands without having to worry about this device because it can follow my path. Wherever I go, this robot follows me. So that's advantageous because then I don't have to put my suction device, for example, down to manipulate the microscope.
Yeah.
And then the other reason why it's advantageous is because I can stand in a very comfortable position and operate rather than hunch over and look through a microscope. And then just the visual optics is incredibly superior, far superior than anything that the microscope can offer.
Right.
You know, just like the cell phones of 10 years ago, right? I mean, if you compare a cell phone of 10 years ago to now, you can see that everything nowadays is smaller, better. The screens are more colorful. So the same for us, you know, the optics of this device allows us to see things in a degree of resolution that we could never see before.
Yeah. So in the surgery room, you know, huge television screens that basically you're able to look at, I mean, I don't know, how far does it magnify? How many times does it magnify?
More than
many. Yeah, I mean, it's tiny. But talk a little bit about that surgeon fatigue just for a minute, because, you know, on the days that I have had the honor to be in there with you, Dr. Reinard, you know, I've been in on maybe a fourth or fifth surgery in a row. I mean, you're operating on a lot of patients at once. So if you are hunched over like this for 12, 16 hours in a day, that fatigue has to be really bad for a surgeon.
Yeah, I mean,
it certainly
is. You know, this device sort of eliminates that. I mean, we still have to do what we have to do. The work is still there. You know, it requires many hours of concentration, but not having to look through a narrow scope, not having to wear my loops and being hunched over for several hours, it certainly helps.
Yeah.
And the one thing that we didn't talk about is the capability that this device affords us as far as teaching other people. So for example, if I'm operating and I'm using a microscope, which you've seen me do a case under the microscope, the resolution is not as fine, the pictures aren't as crisp, and you may not see as much. Whereas with this device, the surgical field is projected on a 100-inch high-resolution screen. Everybody can see it in the operating room. I can see it. My scrub tech can see it. Medical students who visit the operating room can see it. So it's a better teaching tool as well.
Right. So they're able to see a lot more and see what you're doing and also just kind of see how that technology works, because not every health system has this technology. ProMedica is the only one here in Northwest Ohio to have that. Yeah. So that's pretty exciting that you're able to use that. And as you said, a teaching tool for the residents who, you know, are learning, and something that you might also be for them to look at even from a home computer or something at some point, right?
Right. So the device actually allows us to project whatever is happening in the operating room to remote locations. So we can have residents, for example, at University of Toledo, or physicians, primary care physicians who want to visit the neuroscience center, and we can project images live from the operating room to a learning center, and people can follow along with us. They can call into the OR and ask us questions. We can walk them through what we're doing. Yeah. So it's an incredible all around package.
Yeah. It's also not as long of a recovery for people. It used to be that if you knew somebody was having brain surgery years ago, they might be in the hospital for a really extended period of time, but you are able to, with, you know, smaller incisions and the new technology, be able to get people home where they want to be a little quicker, right?
Right. I mean, it's partly related to the technology. Certainly, if you make a smaller incision, if you take a tumor out through a 2-centimeter incision utilizing a tube, the recovery is much shorter than if you were to do a big operation. But I don't want to say that it's entirely the device. A lot of the reasons why our patients do so well and go home early is because of the supportive care afterwards. I mean, there's an incredible amount of knowledge that we've gained over the years. The science of anesthesia has advanced tremendously.
Yeah.
So it's the entire experience, really, but this certainly helps.
Yeah. Okay, so we want to, if you're just joining us, let you know that we're talking with Dr. Kevin Reinard. He's a neurosurgeon here at ProMedica, and we're talking all things brain today. So if you have any questions about your brain health, about any brain diseases, about brain surgery, we invite you to join us for this discussion. Put your comments below. Remember that this is a public space, so any private information that you don't want to share specifically, you can just be general about these questions, and we'll try to answer the best that we can. We don't want to get use anybody's private information, but if you'd like to ask a question, we'd certainly invite you to ask a question while you have the doctor here live to answer a question here for you. So we've talked a little bit about aneurysms. I want to talk about Alzheimer's disease, if we can talk about that for a little bit, because it's something that affects so many people. And I know we're coming up on an awareness month, I think, for Alzheimer's too in October. So causes memory loss, confusion, you know, other things. What are the stages of Alzheimer's, and how do we first kind of notice it in ourselves or in our loved ones?
So that's a very loaded question, but let's just talk about...
That's my forte.
Yeah, loaded let's questions. Just talk about briefly about Alzheimer's. So Alzheimer's is a neurodegenerative disease. So basically what that means is that there is a process that is actively reducing the number of brain cells. And to the best of my knowledge and to the best of the scientific community's knowledge, Alzheimer's occurs when certain toxins accumulate in brain cells and then render them not functional.
Useless.
And so as a result of that, it's a global problem. It could affect multiple functions because Alzheimer's doesn't differentiate between, for example, brain cells that are in the frontal lobe versus the brain cells that are in the occipital lobe. It affects all brain cells. And as a result, you can see a progressive decline in multiple functions. So people will have memory issues, they'll have personality changes, they'll have balance difficulties, they'll have urinary symptoms. and it's a very, very complicated disease and one that the scientific community has been battling for many, many, many years. And every year, there's more promising data that's coming out that shows that we're making inroads. But it is a vastly complicated disease. There are, in fact, specialized neurologists that have dedicated their life and seek special training just to deal with Alzheimer's.
Anything that we can do, you know, I've heard doing crossword puzzles, you know, working on trivia games or, you know, certain types of puzzles, putting puzzles together, things that keep your brain active as we get older. Are there things, do those things help?
So I'm not an Alzheimer's expert at the forefront, but I've reviewed some of the literature, and to the best of my knowledge, exercising, having a healthy mind, having a healthy brain, having a healthy body, could certainly delay the onset or the severity of the disease. But if somebody's diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, you can't basically prevent it. If it's meant to happen, it could potentially happen. And there's various reasons for that. There are certain people that have a genetic predisposition to having Alzheimer's, and there are certain environmental factors as well.
But are there treatments?
Not to the best of my understanding.
Yeah.
There are no treatments, but there are certainly medications available on the market that are FDA approved that can delay some of the symptoms or reduce some of the side effects, the symptoms of the disease.
Okay. If you have any questions about Alzheimer's, I know it's a disease that affects a lot of families out there. We'd love to hear your questions about anything brain. We're talking with neurosurgeon, ProMedica neurosurgeon, Dr. Kevin Reinard today, and he's talking about all things brain. So neurosurgery, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, stroke, aneurysm, we're talking about all of those things here today. If you have any questions, remember it's a public space, and so we're asking you to keep your private information private if you don't want everybody to see it, but we do welcome your personal questions here today if you'd like to ask a question of the doctor. Let's talk a little bit about stroke, because it's something that a lot of people, I mean thousands of people, suffer from strokes every year. Is that something that's getting better? Are people heeding the warnings? I know there are some things we can do to reduce our risk of stroke, right?
Yes. I mean, again, stroke is a very, very big topic. We can probably spend the next hour just talking about the stroke, but just so that the audience understands, a stroke by definition is something that results in loss of function. And there's different types of stroke. The most common type of stroke that the audience may be familiar with is the ischemic type, which is it results because there's something happens that blocks the blood supply to a certain part of the brain. And as a result, the brain cells die and you have loss of function. So for example, somebody can have an ischemic stroke that results in paralysis, because the blood supply to the part of the brain that controls arm function has been affected. but not all strokes are ischemic strokes. You can have, for example, hemorrhagic strokes. You can have traumatic strokes. You know, if somebody hit me in the head with a baseball, I could sustain a stroke. It could cause bleeding and a stroke. Not all strokes necessarily occur in unhealthy individuals. You can
Right.
be very healthy. Seemingly and not know about it, but for example, you know, in a 30-year-old healthy individual, you can have what's called a dissection. You can have a spontaneous disruption of the blood vessel that carries blood to the brain and suffer a stroke. I've had personally patients who have suffered a stroke weightlifting. We had a young lady, I want to say about 6 months ago, who was lifting weights, and all of a sudden she felt dizzy, went to a local ER, and she was diagnosed with a significant stroke that actually required surgery.
Wow.
So it's a very, very broad topic. Hundreds of thousands of people are affected. A lot of the public measures that are in place have improved the outcomes. Most importantly is this notion that if you see somebody who may demonstrate signs of a stroke, immediately call 911.
Yeah.
There's a golden window of opportunity where you can actually preserve neurologic function. So this is why it's important, for example, the FAST initiative. You know, if you see somebody who may have numbness or tingling, or may have visual symptoms, or if they start stuttering, call 911, because they need to be rushed quickly to a hospital where a dedicated stroke specialist has to evaluate the patient. And if they find that the patient is suffering a stroke, they can do something about it. They can unblock blood vessels, they can initiate therapy to prevent stroke, and it's
right.
all meant to preserve the brain function.
So, and there is, I mean, recently, and when I say recently, in the past several years, obviously this has been used, but there is a medication that can kind of reverse the effects of a stroke if you get to it in that window, right?
Well, the medication you're probably referring to the clot busting medications.
Yes.
You know, it, we're getting into semantics and technicalities, but technically, if somebody has suffered a stroke, you can't reverse it.
Okay.
So a stroke means the function has it's gone.
Okay.
but people could, for example, have TIAs or transient ischemic attacks, which are basically precursors to stroke. So somebody could have numbness and tingling and speech impediments, but if you scan their brain, there hasn't been damage or permanent damage. Yes, those are patients who typically are rushed in and are evaluated by our physicians and receive this clot busting medication that you talk about. Because again, the most common type of a stroke is one that is ischemic, right? So if you have a blockage in one of the arteries, they can give you this medication and open up those pathways and restore the blood flow to the brain, and hopefully patients recover. Yeah. And many do.
Brain can kind of rewire itself too, doesn't it? Sometimes if you are, I mean, I've seen stories on, I remember when we were doing like Children's Miracle Network kind of, you know, stuff where you see the stories on TV, a young man who lost almost half his brain,
right,
on one side and was able to learn to walk and talk and do everything else. That seemed pretty amazing to me, you know, given the traumatic injury that he had, but you see this, I'm sure, in your work all the time.
So it depends. It depends on the nature of injury and then also on the individual and how healthy they are. Typically, younger patients do better. So it is possible for a young individual to sustain a traumatic injury but then recover fully. And what you're referring to is probably an individual who had half of their hemisphere damaged, but they were young enough that the normal side was able to take over function entirely.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that from epilepsy surgery. You know, there are many individuals out there who undergo what's called hemispherectomies. So because of their seizure disorder, they are candidates for removal of an entire half of their brain. And those individuals, when they wake up, they have loss of function, right? They're initially paralyzed. They may have difficulty speaking, but over time, the plasticity of the brain allows those neural networks to reestablish and one side of the brain to take over the function of the other side. And if you see those people 6, 7, 8 months out, they're perfectly normal.
That's just amazing. I mean, it's amazing to think about, right? That you could totally relearn, or that your brain would, you know, I'm just gonna say rewire itself to be able to do all of those things again.
Right, but the unfortunate part is that doesn't necessarily happen in older people.
Okay.
And where the cutoff is, I don't think the scientific community has an agreement on. You know, it's not like every individual over 40 years old may not have the capacity to, you know, form those connections again. But the general consensus is that the younger you are, the better the outcome may be if you have a brain injury.
Yeah. You feel like we know so much more about the brain, or is there just still a lot that's mysterious about the brain to even experts like yourself?
I think we know a lot more than we did, say, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And even within the last 5 or 10 years, the scientific community has been able to decode the brain, right? So there's a lot of genes that were unknown that make us who we are, that are responsible for our consciousness and may or may not lead to cancers that we didn't know about that we do know about now. So we do know more, but I don't think the brain has been entirely decoded.
So what about, what can we tell about the brain from our DNA? You know, I mean, that's been something that's been big, where they're finding all sorts of markers for certain diseases and things like that. Is there anything that we can tell about the brain from our DNA?
So let's step back and I'm going to give you an analogy.
Okay.
So when I think of the brain, I think of a computer, right? If you and I open up a computer and look at the memory chip and look at the parts that make up that computer, we could have an idea of where the computer was made, how much memory space it has, how fast it may operate, and so forth. But we may not know about who's going to use the computer, what they're going to use it for, how many pictures they're going to record on it, whether it's going to have documents or be used for certain purposes or not, right? So the same with the human brain. So the human brain, the DNA code may give insight into the number of brain cells, whether or not certain diseases are in the future. If somebody, for example, harbors a genetic mutation that may make them more prone to having a certain type of cancer, but it's not going to tell us anything about that person's consciousness. It's not going to tell us anything about whether or not that individual is going to fall in love or not fall in love, or be good at math and be a musical savant or not, because those are learned experiences.
What about cases where people do go in for brain surgery? Sometimes we see this, and all of a sudden have a traumatic brain injury, and all of a sudden have a talent or, you know, some ability to do something that they were not able to do before that. How does that work? Have you seen that in your years of practice?
I have. And again, it just shows you how complex the neural circuitry is. Is you go in and you damage one area of the brain and some other part may take over. And we've had patients in our neurosurgical service who have come in and had brain surgery and then afterwards woke up and spoke French. But that doesn't come without some background, right? So that individual, it's not like if I sustain traumatic brain injury, I'm going to wake up and learn French, because I have never learned French, right? So, but I've learned German. I went to school in Germany. So it's possible that if I sustain brain injury, I may wake up and lose the capacity to speak English and then revert to speaking German, right? If I hit my head, I don't think I'm going to wake up and speak French, because those parts of my brain have not developed, right? So there is no understanding of the French language or syntax or grammar in my brain come out, essentially.
What about the creative stuff? You know, people come out and all of a sudden they're brilliant painters or brilliant sculptors. You know, they talk about that left brain, right brain, you know, kind of thing. I mean, that happens to people too, where they just have these creative spurts, right?
Very rarely. Mm-hmm. Very rare. It's very rare. And that's why you hear about it. The vast majority of people, when they suffer injury, they actually lose function. So, but yes, it's possible.
We want to remind you that we are here talking with Dr. Kevin Reinard. He is a ProMedica neurosurgeon. We're talking about the brain today, brain diseases, brain function. Anything you'd like to know about the brain, we're happy to answer your questions. So please do feel free to leave a question for us. I'm kind of trying to monitor while I'm talking, but I'm so fascinated by everything we're learning here today. Please ask your questions in a respectful way. Don't give away anybody's personal information. Remember that it is a public space and we're trying to be respectful of people. One of the things that you do a lot is brain tumor work. And so let's talk a little bit about that. How does that happen? Where do those come from?
So to the best of our knowledge, brain tumors happen because of genetic miscalculations or genetic mutations, where an individual may have a gene that's been silent for several years, and then because of certain environmental risk factors or genetic risk factors, that gene will then mutate and turn a normal brain cell into a cancerous cell. So that's one type of brain tumor, which is the primary brain tumor. And then there is the metastatic type of brain tumor, which are tumors that originate from other parts of the body. So for example, one of the most common brain tumors that we take out are metastatic lung cancer. Mm-hmm. And that's because, unfortunately, even in 2018, there are a lot of individuals who continue to smoke. And so lung cancer is a big problem in our society. And anytime an individual has lung cancer, they have a risk of having the tumor metastasize in the brain. So basically, when I counsel patients, I tell them that if they have a primary brain tumor, they probably were predisposed. There was something in their genetic code that made it more likely for them than the average person to have a brain tumor. Mm-hmm. And if they have a metastatic or a secondary type of tumor, then we know why, because of the original cancer, being lung or breast or whatever.
Can you tell right away when you're operating on someone if the tumor is cancerous or not? I mean, there are benign brain tumors, right?
So to arrive at that conclusion, you have to synthesize a bunch of different information. So going into an operation, I already have a sense of whether the tumor is going to be benign or malignant based on the way the patient presented, based on the findings on the MRI study, based on their age, based on the location of the tumor. And certainly in the operating room, based on what I see, characteristics of the tumor, whether it's bloody or not, whether it's fibrous or not, whether it has infiltrated the brain, whether it's caused destruction of the surrounding bone, I have a sense of whether it's malignant or not. But
you can see that before you even go in on imagery?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
But also during surgery, I can see how aggressive the tumor is and if it has any of those aggressive features. Mm-hmm. But even if I think a tumor is aggressive, I won't be able to sub-differentiate that aggressive tumor into different kinds. So I can, for example, you know, I can leave the operating room and know that a tumor, for example, is malignant or it's a type 4 brain tumor, but I won't be able to tell the individual whether it's a glioblastoma versus a gliosarcoma, because that type of differentiation only happens at the cell level. Mm-hmm. So an expert has to look at the cell line and determine whether there are certain characteristics that makes it a glioblastoma versus a gliosarcoma.
We talked a little earlier about the breakthroughs in the technology to help you kind of reach those brain tumors and make sure you can take out as much as you can without damaging the healthy brain tissue around it. Are there other treatments that are helping people survive brain tumors longer now?
Yes. So if you look at the historical data, patients generally are doing better. And I should say that we're only talking about aggressive brain tumors. So if we're talking about only aggressive tumors, the survival rate is better. It's not significantly better, but it is better than it was, let's say, in the 1970s. And mm-hmm. part of that is because of the early diagnosis.
Yes.
Right. So we're catching these tumors earlier. If you catch a tumor earlier, if you can offer somebody surgery, and if you can resect the tumor safely without causing any functional deficit, then the patients will live longer. But unfortunately, there's still no cure. So we struggle on a daily basis with that.
What about, a tumor? I mean, I guess if a tumor is going to continually, even if it's benign, I did have a good friend many years ago who had a benign tumor. They took it out. It grew back. They took it out again. But how many times are you going to go in and operate on a tumor like that? Do you see those that regrow that you have to constantly kind of attend to?
So it depends. It depends on the age of the person. It depends on the type of tumor. It depends on the location. For example, if somebody has a benign meningioma, which is a type of tumor that's benign but could potentially recur, and if it's in a favorable spot, let's say it's in the frontal lobe on the right side, and the patient is young, let's say they're 30 years old, if you take that tumor out and it recurs, I think it's pretty reasonable to offer the patient another surgery and take it out. But you know, if the tumor is in a very complicated location around the brainstem, and let's say the individual is 75 years old, probably not a good idea to go back a second time. And that's where other forms of therapy, the chemotherapy drugs, the radiation therapy come into play.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit. So, and it's really a case-by-case basis where you're looking at quality of life and, mm-hmm. you know, trying to make sure that you're managing the risk for each individual patient. But let's talk a little bit about chemotherapy, because I had always heard that, you know, brain tumors were tough to treat with chemotherapy because it doesn't all it pass through the brain membrane or something.
The brain barrier.
Yeah. Right. So talk how does that work exactly? And there are chemos that are effective though, you said.
Yes. So there are chemos now that are effective at crossing that barrier mm-hmm. and getting into the brain. But the problem is that no chemo is very effective at killing and eradicating the disease. Mm-hmm. And this is why there's still no cure for brain cancers. But certainly chemotherapy drugs now that we use in brain cancer patients are much more effective than they were before, and they're more well tolerated, right? So one of the most common drugs, for example, Temodar, it's a specialty pill that you get from a specialty pharmacy, and there's probably people or individuals out there that take the drug that you wouldn't even know are on chemotherapy.
And then also radiation is still something that you all use for brain tumors as
Definitely,
well.
Definitely, yeah. One of the standards of therapy for aggressive brain tumors is not only chemotherapy, but radiation therapy as well.
You feel like we talk about these targeted therapies also, the immunotherapies mm-hmm. that people are using. Are you seeing that in neurology as well?
Yes, yes. Yeah. And this is why every time we do a brain operation, the specimen is sent off and it's analyzed pretty extensively. And what the pathologists are actually looking for are different genetic mutations, which would make the individual either favorable in terms of prognosis or not favorable. And also because there are drugs now that target specific mutations. So for example, there's the ATRX mutation versus the 1P19Q mutations. These terms may not mean something to the layperson, but to the oncologist who's treating the individual, they mean something because you can tailor the chemotherapy medication to specifically target that mutation.
Yeah, it's really exciting. It's really exciting time in medicine right now with all of that stuff. So you have reason to be hopeful. If you hear that diagnosis, you have a brain tumor, right?
Yes, more hopeful than ever before, but there's certainly still some profound challenges ahead for us.
Yeah. We want to remind you that we are here with ProMedica neurosurgeon, Dr. Kevin Reinard. He's talking all things brain with us today. We're welcoming your questions. If you have any questions you'd like to ask of the doctor here, we'll be here until about 1 o'clock. Answering questions and talking about brain health and brain disease. So please join the discussion. And if you have a question, I'd be happy to ask the doctor about that as we go through here. We've talked about a lot of brain health and brain disease, but a lot of what you do also and those things that you get called in on emergency basis for are traumatic brain injury. So let's talk a little bit about that. Job accidents, motorcycle accidents, car accidents, things that happen to people still happen pretty frequently, right? See a lot of those, and you're having maybe better and better luck being able to help those people. Are there things that are happening in your industry that are helping you help those people better?
Yes, and I say that because it's a very complicated issue, right? So we, as a society, we haven't made significant inroads when it comes to, for example, traumatic brain injury in the adolescent population. It still is one of the biggest challenges for public health individuals, and we see that here in Toledo. You know, the summer months were bad months for Toledo citizens because there were a number of accidents that unfortunately caused significant damage in multiple people. So one of the areas that we can improve significantly is educating the public about public safety measures, driving and adhering to the laws, traffic laws, not driving under the influence, wearing seat belts if they're on a motorcycle, to wear a helmet. But if an unfortunate traumatic injury occurs, then yes, I mean, there are certainly better treatment options than in the past. I mean, patients come in, they may have an operation, but really where we have made significant strides is in the ICU environment, because there's just so much knowledge base that we can rely on now. So many parameters that we can control that we were not able to control in the past. Everything from brain tissue oxygenation to the brain perfusion, to pressure monitoring, to monitoring various different organ systems, and ways of preventing progression of damage that individuals do tend to do better. But unfortunately, rather than relying on the improvements in the ICU care, I'd rather see these problems prevented. So I'd rather see fewer car accidents, I'd rather see fewer motorcycle accidents and such.
In fact, when I asked Dr. Reinard, what can we do basically to protect our brain health and make our brains healthier, the number one thing you said was?
Prevention.
Yeah. Right. Prevent traumatic injury to your brain. So that means wearing helmets when you're riding bikes and motorcycles and just, you know, not taking chances or being dangerous with your activities in a lot of cases like that. You were talking about kind of some of those things in the ICU. One of those things, brain swelling is often one of the things that is a real concern because you know, and can be very damaging to people. You use a brain cooling method sometimes to be able to get that swelling down for people?
In very rare situations. So let's talk about brain swelling. So brain swelling is a problem, and it is actually one of the most important reasons why people do poorly after traumatic brain injury, because the brain is a closed space, mm-hmm. right? And so if there is pressure problems, the brain is going to get squished, to put in lay terms. And so when a patient with traumatic brain injury makes it to the ICU, the most critical variable that we like to control is the brain pressure. And there's various ways of controlling that. We can put patients on medications that reduce the swelling. We can put patients on medications that remove extra fluid in the brain, because extra fluid is directly correlated to brain swelling. And and this is done through different medications. And in very rare situations, yes, we can cool people, but that's not necessarily in traumatic brain injury as much as it is in traumatic arrest. Mm-hmm. So if somebody has a cardiac reason that led to global ischemia or global ischemic attack, then yes, we can cool individuals. And the reasoning behind that is that if you cool the individual, you're going to reduce their basal metabolic rate, or you're essentially going to shut down their engine, their body's engine. And as such, you're going to divert most of the energy that would have been expended on brain recovery and not so much on generating heat and peristalsis and breathing and such.
So there's a lot that we can do to prevent traumatic brain injury. Obviously, you're going to have car accidents, you know, building accidents, work accidents, things that happen like that. And people have, again, reason to be hopeful with all the new information you are constantly learning and sure. and the new care that you're able to give to people, right?
Yeah, but there's nothing better than prevention. So yeah. To all the teenagers out there, to the young men and women out there, you know, don't speed, don't drink when you're driving, and wear your seatbelts.
Are car accidents, is that one of the biggest things that you see that causes traumatic brain injury?
You know, I don't know the exact numbers, but I think I'm accurate in my estimate that probably about 20-30% of all the brain or spine cases that we deal with at Toledo Hospital, certainly in the summer months where everybody's out, is related to trauma. So yeah. it's a significant chunk of our business.
And it's not just brain injury per se, but also spinal cord injury, right? You treat that as well.
Correct.
So tell us a little bit about that and how that works. I mean, we're talking about people being paralyzed perhaps, or, you know, losing some of their physical function because of some of those accidents as well.
Right. So, I mean, just like the brain is encased in this rigid skull, the spinal cord is encased in a spinal column, which is also rigid. And if it were to be subject to a lot of force, it swells, and it's the swelling that then causes permanent dysfunction. And so if somebody has traumatic spinal cord injury, then the goal is to decompress the spinal cord, reduce the swelling, and if necessary, stabilize the spine so that individual can get up and mobilize.
If you have any questions you would like to ask Dr. Reinard, we'd love to hear them. He's here with us until 1 o'clock. What time we got, Katie? Just a few more minutes. So if you have any questions, don't be shy. Hop on and ask us about it while we have the doctor here live. Again, we'll be here until 1 o'clock. And again, remember, it is a public forum, so we don't want you disclosing anyone's privacy and private information here on the public forum. We want you to be aware of that as well. You've been practicing for how many years?
I've been in neurosurgery since 2008.
Okay. And I'm not sure that there is an industry where things change more rapidly than medicine and healthcare, right? I mean, how do you keep up with all of the breakthroughs, the, you know, trials, all the things that are going on that you might be able to offer to your patients here?
Well, I don't think there's any physician out there that can keep up with all the literature, and that's part of the reason why medicine has become super subspecialized, right? So within the world of neurology, you have an epileptologist or an epilepsy expert, but then within the world of epilepsy, you have an epileptologist who deals with pediatrics and one who deals with adults. Mm-hmm. That's part of the reason. Part of the reason is because there's so much data and literature on the adult as well as the pediatric epilepsy population that you just can't keep up with, right? So that's part of the reason for this trend. And the other, or how we, to answer your second part, how we keep up with this is there, it's constant education. I mean, you know, I haven't stopped learning. You know, it's, you know, attending national conferences, there's periodicals that come out, journals, scientific journals, you go to scientific meetings. And, you know, the internet certainly makes it easier because now we have access to information immediately, no matter where we are.
Right. Do you have a case that was just like the greatest case of your career where you thought maybe somebody really wasn't going to do very well and they turned out to do really well? I mean, you must see what most of us would consider to be miracles happen in your line of work.
Yeah, I mean, it's not necessarily just one case, you know, it's just, it could be a very simple case, it could be a very complicated case, but there are hundreds of cases where the individuals have done well, and certainly some where, you know, I haven't met their expectations or I haven't met my own expectation. But, you know, every day, I mean, that's one of the beauty of our job is that we're surprised. We're surprised at how incredible the human body is, how it functions, how much we can do, how certain people recover from traumatic injury. And that's what's exciting about it. It keeps us going.
Yeah. It's really, really amazing to be able to see what you all are doing. Talk just very briefly about the new neuroscience center, the affiliation between ProMedica and the University of Toledo. That's really exciting. Brand new building. You've probably seen it driving on 475 there.
So it's a wonderful place. It's great for not only the physicians, but the patients, but I'd like to call it sort of the one-stop shop, you know, where people who may not necessarily live in Toledo and may live in the surrounding communities can come to town and see multiple specialties in one day. Mm-hmm. Right? And that's very efficient for them. So they can come in, for example, they can have their MRI done in the morning, they can have an x-ray done, they can see a neurosurgeon, they can see a neurologist and leave the building perhaps at the end of the day with a very comprehensive understanding of what it is that they have to deal with.
Yeah.
As opposed to, you know, shipping around town and traveling between multiple office locations. And so from the patient side, it's very efficient and it's great from a patient satisfaction standpoint. From my perspective, it's great because I can interact with other physicians.
Right.
If I have a question about a patient with Alzheimer's, I can leave my clinic and go across the hall and talk to a neurologist. And so it's great. It creates a collegial educational environment.
Yeah, a lot of collaborative spirit over there where you all can run ideas by, or as you said, you know, someone that might have a specialty in something that is not necessarily your specialty would be able to help. I'm always interested because I think people tend to think of especially something as severe or important as a brain injury, and they think they have to go out of town for treatment. And I always am telling people, you know, we have the best equipment. I mean, we have technology here that nobody else in Ohio has at ProMedica, and just some of the greatest doctors as well. What would you say to people who might be looking out of town for their treatment?
Well, I would tell people that the care that we deliver is standardized, and almost everything that we do on a daily basis at ProMedica is driven by guidelines. And that's not just here at Toledo, it's everywhere. Because now more than ever before, there are oversight committees that mandate that we practice medicine within certain confines. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. It's important that individuals in Toledo get the same care as individuals in Stanford, California, right? So I can't practice my, you know, Reinard unique way of brain surgery. I have to do the same type of craniotomy incision. I use the same equipment to remove the brain tumor. The pathologist will use the same guidelines to diagnose an individual with a brain tumor. The radiation oncologist who delivers the radiation has to adhere to the Cancer Society guidelines as far as the dosing is concerned and so forth. So, you know, I certainly understand if individuals want to go outside, but I would just reassure them that the practice of medicine is very much standardized. And whether you're here or in Hong Kong, the treatment of an aggressive brain tumor, for example, is the same.
And you'd put your team up against pretty much anybody, right? You guys have a pretty good team over there. Yeah. Anything else as we have our last kind of minute or so in this discussion? It's been fascinating, Doctor, just to learn more about, you know, brain disease, brain health, traumatic brain injury. I just feel like we have a lot of reasons to be grateful to kind of be alive in this era of medicine. And you probably see that every day in the operating room.
Yeah. I mean, when you look at where modern science and the science of medicine was around the turn of the century and where we are now, it's just fascinating. I look forward to the future.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being here and being part of this discussion. We want to thank you for being with us today. Hopefully you were able to learn something about your brain health, traumatic brain injury. And don't forget that, you know, if you are noticing any symptoms in someone and that you love, you know, one of your friends or family members, or even in yourself, to make sure that you reach out to your family doctor or to a specialist to make sure that you are taking care of yourself proactively and getting things done. We want to make sure you find them quickly and take care of them in the early stages, right? So thanks for being with us, and thank you, Dr. Reinard.
Thank you.